Good afternoon, Vasudha. Vasudha from which state, Vasudha?
Sir, I am from AP, sir, Andhra Pradesh.
Which district, Andhra Pradesh?
Nellore, SPSR, Nellore district.
Nellore, okay.
Oh, good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon. Nirupama, you are from which district?
Nellore district, sir. Andhra Pradesh, Nellore.
Nellore, okay.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon. You are from Sharnalata, huh?
I am from Anantapur, sir.
Anantapur, okay.
Yes, sir.
Anantapur is very close to Bangalore.
Yes, sir.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon, Sushitra. You are from Karnataka?
Telangana, sir.
Telangana, which district?
Peddapalli.
Peddapalli, okay. Karimnagar, Peddapalli. Right.
Yes, sir. Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon, Prabhu. You are from?
Sir, Karnataka, sir. Kola district.
Kolara? Okay.
Yes, sir.
Which taluk? Kola district, which taluk?
Srinivaspura taluk, sir.
Srinivaspura? Srinivaspura.
Ramesh Kumar Constance, sir.
I'm going to talk to you on this particular topic called evaluation. And it's a very important topic because all these results and all these things, evaluation, question paper setting, all this part of our things, and this is very crucial for SSLC level examination. So we'll talk about that. Shall we begin? So here we'll talk about these points. We'll begin today, but it will continue. All right? In one session, we will not be able to complete. So we'll continue. So I'll get around 5 sessions probably. So 3 sessions, we talked about TSA professional development, the very concept of professional development. Now 2 topics, two periods probably I'll have for this evaluation. Today, we'll talk about this. So here in this topic, we'll talk about following points, basic issues in evaluation and objectives of teaching, objectives of evaluation, criteria of evaluation, types of tests based on function and content, objectives of questions, blueprint and question paper setting. We'll talk about this. All of you are muted. Malika, yeah, Jogesh, no, Bagesh, please mute your mic. So the main objectives of this particular area called evaluation is to assess merit of first objective, broad objective of evaluation, is to assess the merit of curriculum and find answers to the following. Right? To what extent the curriculum is achieving its goal? This assessment begins from preparation of curriculum. And then the curricular goals, objectives, aims. So as we conduct transact sessions, implement the curriculum syllabus, we need to assess to what extent curriculum is achieving its goals. Every 5 years, every 10 years, we change the curriculum. and incorporate new things, the recent trends, something like this. But it's a huge amount of expenditure from the department. So sometimes it goes up to 10 years. Now, Andhra Pradesh upper primary, last 2-3 years, they are changing it. So new textbook is prepared for class 7. I was involved in class 7 textbook, English textbook. So that is how I came to know. I was editor of their class 7, Blossom 7. So we need to, so now it's a new curriculum. So we need to assess after transacting the sessions and getting SSLC results, we need to check or assess to what extent the curriculum is achieving goals. Is this the right curriculum? Is it difficult, average, or easy, something like this? Or does the new curriculum achieving its goal in terms of helping learners develop their language skills? Similarly, to what extent the teachers, administrators, students, parents, and employers are satisfied with the curriculum? Right? Are they happy with the present curriculum? Do they find any difficulty? What are the new things incorporated? So those are the main things. And then those involved in developing and teaching a language course, are they satisfied? So we need to assess that also. The curriculum compares with other of its kinds, okay? Is this better curriculum than the previous one? Is this better curriculum than the other states? Okay, we also need to assess those things, okay? And what is happening in classroom and school where it is being implemented? Is there any change in the transaction of classes and production of language because of this new curriculum? So that is also another objective of assessment. Okay, we need to assess that also. So what is happening in the classroom, right? When this new textbook, new curriculum is being implemented, and then products of this curriculum are able to meet the market demand, section demands, higher education aspirants, for example. Does the curriculum provide sufficient language exposure so that they, when they pass SSLC and join colleges, universities, do they perform better or the same? All right, we also need to see that also. And then there are different aspects of curriculum that we need to understand as teachers teaching English at high school level. So these aspects are aspect of curriculum insights they provide about curriculum that we need to understand the curriculum design, quality of planning and organization, how curriculum is prepared, what is the planning kind of things, you know, how is it organized, is it better than the previous one or the same. People say, what there is a saying called old wine in new bottle, all right? Sometimes that happens, so we need to check that also. And then also see the syllabus and content materials. Are they relevant? Are the materials relevant? Are they easy, difficult, or good, better text, something like this. And then we also need to see classroom process, what extent the program is implemented, material of instructions, all right, kind of help provided to learners. Is this the better, material provided to learners for developing their listening, speaking, reading, writing, all right? And then also we need to see the teachers about teaching, perception about the curriculum and things taught by them. Are they quite comfortable? Do they have any problems? All right. Sometimes you see what happens, and to be frank, you see every 5 years or 10 years, we change the curriculum. We rewrite new textbooks. All right. So curriculum is changed, all right, syllabus is changed, material is changed, but the teacher remains the same, all right? Teacher remains the same teacher. We cannot change the teacher, okay? And teachers also don't want to get changed, okay? So now what happens when we have a new curriculum and new textbook, new syllabus, do as a teacher go undergo some sort of sense keeping the curriculum in mind, or we remain the same? All right. Now, success and failure of program depends on three things called 3M. 3M ante methods. All right. Called methods, okay, 3M ante methods, material, and main, okay. Main andre teacher, okay. Main andre teacher, teachers, okay. Now, in most cases, what happened, method is developed by the experts based on their recent insight, research, other things. Methods of teaching English as a second language is decided by the experts. Material, that is content, textbook, is also prepared by experts or prepared by teachers, practicing teachers, with advice or with guidance of some experts, language experts, domain experts. All right. So this should always be comparatively better, because all things are taken into account while deciding a particular methods of teaching and materials for teaching. But man is called teachers, all right? So teachers should understand the concept of very methods and materials, and based on that, we need to keep ourselves, you know, up to date to that, to transact that. That is, we need to understand the philosophy of the textbook and the curriculum. So that happens. Some teachers, that happens immediately when they find a new textbook, new curriculum, they study, you know, very nicely, scrutinizingly, and then they change. They change the methodology of transaction. But some teachers don't do that, okay? And that is a problem, right? Some, they follow the same methods what they have been using for last 20 years. As I told you, you know, my first sessions, that we are all born and brought up in 20th century. We are 20th century, you know, learners, 20th century teachers, 20th century born, all right? But the children we are handling today are 21st century. Now, keeping this point in mind, we need to keep ourselves, you know, updated and make ourselves 21st century teachers. In order to become 21st century teachers, we need to undergo some sort of changes, learn new skills. That is called 21st century skills. And then only we'll be relevant in transacting the materials using the right approach, right methods. Okay, so that sometimes is a challenging thing. Anything new is always challenging. Now, I have learned somewhere, they say, many teachers say, complain, they say, now this is a new textbook, I have to prepare the lesson plan again, I have to do this, all these things, Now, once you say, I have to, then there is a problem, that you are doing something under compulsion. But the same, if you change your mental attitude and say, I get to do this. What is the difference between I have to do this and I get to do this? So when I say I have to do this, so we are doing under compulsion, by force. But when I say I get to do this, I get a chance to do something new. And that is what, you know, we need to keep in mind and change accordingly. Then only the program will be successful. Otherwise, all programs, even though textbook curriculums are changed, the program remains the same, SSLC result remains the same, something like nothing happens, no improvement happens. Because we as teacher, the main driver, all right, if they don't change, then there is no change. So that's a little bit of friendly caution, actually. All right, so I would like to say. And at the same time, we need to see the learners also, things learned, what they have learned, and what is the perception about the lesson taught to them, all right? What is their participation? So we also need to assess that through this evaluation process. And then monitoring progress, okay? What is kind of evaluation that we are doing, especially formative evaluation? We check the process. Today's world is based on product-oriented. You see open market, outside market, all these are product oriented, but goal oriented, all right? Goal oriented, I'll have to get 90% mark, I'll have to get 95% mark, I'll have to get 100% mark. But nobody focus on the process. Process is what is important. How am I learning this new language? Okay? And teacher as teacher, we need to assess learners' process of learning. If you take care of the process of learning from the beginning, product will automatically come, right? Yes or no? Just tell me, if we take care of the process and if we follow the process rigorously, let's say, for example, how do I learn different language, new language, okay? So if we focus it and keep asking, keep checking whether children are following the right process in learning, then they will learn it. Concept will be formed and they will be able to do well in the examination. But we are all the time we're talking about no SSLC, you know, result, you must get 100% mark in English, 100 in mathematics. Okay, we are all focusing on the target and forget the process, what we are doing right now. All right. And in market also, people say, you know, especially credit card. Credit card is product. Okay. How you earn money, that is not a question. You have a credit card, you can buy things. And you can think of payment later. So that is what is the problem in learning. In academic things, we should always focus on the process. How I write a small paragraph, right? How do I write a topic sentence? How do I add a new point to it? How I select a relevant example? How do I connect example with the topic? Have I focused on that thing? That is called process. So if process is taken care of, product will automatically come. Cooking, say, for example. All right. So once you, you know, start putting things right way, in a right way, rice will get cooked. Sambar will get cooked, prepared, all right? So that is, process is important, all right? So that is what is we need to take care of. And learner motivation, monitoring progress to conduct formative chair, learner motivation, effectiveness of teaching and helping learners to essay. In other subject, they get the information. But in language is mother of all subjects. So here, you know, how as the teacher helping the learners to learn the process and then follow the process in a right manner. So that is what, you know, and once they know the process and they enjoy the process, product will automatically come. There won't be burden. Learning will not be a burden. Learning would be enjoyment because you focus on the process. Oh, this is how I write a paragraph. Okay. This is, I could complete it. Okay. With less mistake, something like this. So once they enjoy doing this thing, result is a matter of product. Okay. That will come automatically. All right. So that's what. And then school, what are the supports, the support provided by the school? Okay. Is there any such kind of support of library facility? All right, video, audio facilities, all right. What are the other material resources that we have in the school? Where children get exposed to those ideas in English and they learn it, okay? So do we have that? If school cannot support it as a teacher, what can I do to provide sufficient exposure to English, all right? I learned long back, you know, learning corners, called learning station, all right? That's a reading station, and then listening station, writing station, okay, poem station, something like this. So this is what, as a teacher, am I providing to learners? Do I carry, bring a book, a small book, story book, the Round the World in 80 Days, something like that, and keep it on the table when I teach? And children look at this, and then somebody might ask you, madam, sir, can I take this book? I want to read it. So this is how we encourage them. I bring a newspaper to my class. If you bring a newspaper to your class, the Times of India, say, for example, children will look at it. What has madam brought? Okay. And then they say, so if you look at them and say, want to read this? Okay, take it. Something like this. So create that kind of atmosphere as a teacher. And you can afford to 100, 200 rupees buying some small novels, okay, small drama, something like this in English. So they will get it. Then learning environment. So that is environment. What kind of environment do we process? First environment, that whatever little we speak in English. Small sentences. Hello, good morning, how are you? Come here, okay, sit down, okay. Two of you sit together, okay, something like that. Small sentences. All right, two or three word sentences. Don't worry, okay? I'll help you, okay? Come here, okay? Something like this. So once children see teacher talking and this talking English, and English is not very difficult, all right? Then they will start speaking, okay? Something like this. And they will develop an interest in the learners, okay? All right? And then staff development, say, it is good that you got an opportunity and joined this training program, 30 day CLT program. So that is the kind of development. We have two kinds of development. One is called horizontal, as I told you, and one is vertical. Okay. So means horizontal, attending different types of training, all right. And then vertical, that pursuing further higher studies, okay? Higher studies or doubling studies. If you have done already one PG, in English, then you can now another do PG on psychology. So you will be a better teacher. You will know, understand the very basics of psychology, something like this. And then finally called decision making, how well the school principal, teachers and others make decisions enabling learners to benefits. What are the other activities that you organize? Festivals, English festivals that you organize, where children get an opportunity to listen to English, read English, speak English, write English, something like this. We can at a school level, we can have inter-school level, we can have essay writing competition, all right, poem reciting competition, all right, inviting expert to talk to the children, right? Something like this. Local expert, there are many other experts from other professions, okay. So, say for example, for your class 10 students, because they undergo a lot of stress and tension, you can always invite a psychologist, counselor, or a doctor, okay, what they should do, what they should not do, all right. You can have that kind of exposure. That way, result will increase. So these are some of the things that is, evaluation doesn't mean checking only learners' achievement, okay, progression. It is also other things that, you know, all this aspect of curriculum that we should also take care of. Hope you got some idea. Did you get some idea? I'm talking only, you can type that you got some ideas. Right. Good. Okay, that will do. Okay. Next point is what is called this, to measure purposes. Okay, measure purposes is basically what I was talking about last 10 minutes is accountability. That we should, as teacher, take accountability of our teaching and learners' progress. That is one thing. That's why when children do well in SSLC exam, who takes the credit? Teacher takes the credit, right? Yes or no? And if they do badly in the examination, who takes the credit? We always give the credit to learners. That because of their, you know, things, they got less mark. Then, but we should always, the way we take credit for children's success, we should also take credit in children's failure also and do the needful. So second is program development. If we see 90% of teachers say this curriculum is little difficult or this and that, and you know, it doesn't serve the practical purpose of learning English of learners, especially listening, speaking, writing, vocabulary and grammar, poems or literary skills, then probably all these points will be taken into account and a new program will be developed. So these are the two measures. And then next, academic purposes, there are three kinds of tests that we are talking about today. One is, as you all know, called formative test. So you all know the meaning of formative. All right, formative, the word formative come from the word called form. Now, form means, form andre, to make, to create, all right, to construct. To form. So from form we say formative, right? And then next is called summative. Sum up means complete, okay? Conclude, okay? And from that we say summative. So these are the two things, test, you know, that evaluation process that we have. One is called formative evaluation, one is called summative process. Formative evaluation is very important because that, you know, we check the process of their learning, how they learn. Do they follow the, you know, appropriate process of learning or not? So formative is we check the process of learners' learning. Summative, we check the amount of learners' learning. How much have they learned? All right. Formative, we check learners' process of learning. How are they learning? What are the strategies are they using in developing vocabulary, knowing the grammar rule and applying those grammar rules in their speech and writing. We see the process, how, what strategies or techniques they are using in listening and understanding, in carrying out conversation, in reading and with comprehension, in writing in brevity and relevance. Are they following the right process? So for these, we as teachers also need to undergo some sort of training in evaluation process. All right. So that is what we do. And next one called eliminative test. Eliminative test is something called eliminative test. This is for teachers. All right. Say sometimes we use different strategies in teaching. Different strategies in teaching. All right. Say peer work. All right. Peer work. All right. Group work. Okay. Group work. Group work. Okay. Whole class lecture, okay, lecture, whole class activity, something like this. Now, when we use different strategies in the classroom transaction, and then we check, assess which one is working well. So sometimes you organize a group work activity, all right, especially in writing or reading, say, for example. Or speaking, presentation skills, all right? Group work. And you see, when you ask them to sit in group of five, they sit in, but out of five, only two students walk, and other three sits idly doing nothing. So you see, group work doesn't work in my session. Then you say, individual activity, and you see, some children work, some children do not know what to do. So they don't write. Then say, this is also not working. Can you give a lecture and ask questions? Some children, only few selected children answer, nothing. So you see, this is also not working. And then you say, let me put them in pair. So one bright student, one little weak student. And they talk to each other, read the textbook and then write. And you see, pair work is working better in my sessions. So this is what is our teacher's strategy of checking his or her own strategies and finding which one is working, which one is not working. That is what is called eliminative test. Is this concept clear? Can you type in the chat box? Yes.
Sir. So formative evaluation, as you mentioned, it's an evaluation technique to identify the process of learning, right?
Process of learning. How they are learning. Is the process correct or wrong process? All right.
Okay, okay.
So check that. Yeah.
Okay. We are used to unit test, midterm test, and likewise. So how should be the format of a formative assessment, right?
Unit test, when you say to, while teaching the unit, you check the process, and at the end of the unit, you see the summative. That is the summative. You check the amount of learning at the end of one unit. How much listening has they developed? How much speaking have they developed? How much reading and writing have they developed? But the moment you begin, you check the process. Are they following the right process of learning vocabulary, its meaning, its pronunciation, its spelling, and both denotation and connotation, the general meaning and the special meaning and a connotation. Denotation is basic meaning, and connotation is special meaning, all right? Say, for example, you're from Kerala, sir, Anup, sir?
Yes, sir.
So you see, there is something called,
I just heard about this formative and summative evaluation in CBSE stream, but in our system, we are not used to with it. We are just thinking about unit test and midterm exam and maybe
unit test is a formative test. But again,
one second,
I'm answering to Anup, sir. You see, unit test is a formative test. The UT is, earlier what happened, we had terminal test, half yearly test and annual test. So 6 months they learn, we don't know where they make mistakes. So now that we have unit system, UT is one unit, and while teaching you observe children's strategies, all right, process of learning. Are they using the, you know, right approach for learning vocabulary, learning grammar rule, applying them in context, and are they developing, have I arranged some listening activity, reading activity, speaking activity, writing activity? How many of them are taking, participating in the activities? Is there any progress, something like this? Okay, so you see throughout the unit, you see all this, you know, process of the learners, of all the students. And then you conduct unit test and see how much they have learned of this, okay? So amount, it comes an amount of learning, process of learning and amount. And then you go for next unit and then happy early, always something. So this is what process, you are taking the process. So if you focus, now presently nobody focuses on process. They always say, you know, unit test, how much did you get? So focus is on the target. And that is why I'm saying that is called product oriented. You want the product, but you don't focus the process of getting it. So format. If from form, that you form that. That is.
You're absolutely mentioning the system which we are following, sir. So,
could you Kerala, please most of you are following. Kerala, so for yes, mine always goes, most of you are following. All
yes,
right, so you do it.
Could you mention a few methods for, I mean, formative assessment?
That we'll talk about that, detail about okay. Talk about these okay. Things. So you see, for vocabulary, say for example, what are the strategies I use for learning vocabulary? All right. So one thing I can say, I see the meaning in the context. That is one strategy. And I can check the dictionary. That is another strategy. Then I can ask my teacher. That is another strategy. So now the student, say Krishnan is your student. Now Krishnan has got three strategies for learning vocabulary. And Vasudevan, he only consult the dictionary. All right. He doesn't ask the teacher. He doesn't try to understand in the context. Now, Vasudevan and Krishnan, what is the difference? Krishnan will try to understand in the context. All right. And when he is reading, he will try to understand the context. And if he gets the right idea, he will understand it. But Basu will wait till he consults the dictionary. So his learning process will stop there unless he has dictionary with him. All right. This is the difference between Basu and Krishnan. Krishnan tries to understand in the context, so his studies works. All right. Basu tries to consult dictionary, means second one, consult dictionary strategy, but his dictionary is not with him. So his learning stops. All right. Now, and Basu will not ask the teacher, but Krishnan will ask the teacher. So what happens? Krishnan, first, he uses one technique. If it works, then he works. If it doesn't work, he'll choose the next one, next strategy, that consult a dictionary. If the what is not in the dictionary, then he will ask the teacher. So he has got three techniques. Whereas Basu uses only dictionary. If the dictionary is not there, his learning stops. If he doesn't find a word in the dictionary, his learning stops. So this is the difference between two learners. And our task is to observe who are using more than one strategies. Is brighter students. And if he's doing, Krishnan is using three strategies, I ask Basu also. So you ask Krishnan, what are the strategies he's using for learning vocabulary? So he will talk. So he will increase that. So we need to focus on this. What are the techniques that we are using? Writing can be developed by writing only. So Krishnan is writing something or other. He's writing about himself, writing about his brother, writing about his sister, writing about his teacher or something. He's writing all the time. Okay. So he is using the right process in learning. Whereas Basu will write only the answer that you ask, homework that you ask. Otherwise, he will not write anything. So Basu will be, you know, ever slowly, slowly, his learning process is not appropriate. So he will not progress further. So you, as a teacher, you observe that. Okay? So apart from this mark system, you know, all these things, you observe their actual process of learning. So that is what I would request you. And think of all this for listening, speaking, reading, writing also, and grammar also, how they learn the grammar rules and how they apply them in when they speak, when they write. So that is what we need to observe. If you guide them using right, you know, technique strategies, your children will shine. You don't need to bother about highest mark. They will get anyway. All right. So something like this. Is that clear, Anup sir? So I was talking about another thing called denotation and connotation. Denotation means
Something clear from the words itself.
Yes. So for example, chair means chair, table means table. But when it's a chairperson, it gives a different meaning. All right.
Of course.
So in Kerala, you always are seeing, you know, Karaskaratin Guru Palala Little Kalandare Kapu Samipatanku. So that is what is called, you know, Karaskaratin Guru Palala Little Kalandare Kapu Samipatandu. That means Karaskaratil is a very bitter seed. If you put this bitter seed in milk, all right, to reduce its bitterness, it will not happen. Milk will get bitter, but still the seed will not get sweeter. So something like, so this is a general meaning. And what does it implicate? What is the implication of this statement? It's something different. Am I right? That you cannot change that, okay? He will change you, but you cannot change him. Something like this. So that is called connotation, implication, or something like this. So in in Kannada we have so in all languages we have gade, that is what is called
gade
proverb always have connotation. Proverb always have connotation. There's, that means something is said but something different is meant. All right, something like this. So this is also Malayali proverb karaskara
hidden meaning.
Hidden meaning. Kalaskara tin kuru palalati kalandra kappu samipadandu, or something like this. So something like this. Right. So we'll
illuminative evaluation. So there
that is not evaluation for children. That is your evaluation of your own strategies.
Peer work, group work.
Yeah. Which strategy that you use, methods, techniques you use, that works better in your classroom? It is your evaluation of your own strategy that you use in the classroom. It is not for children's learning something. It is what techniques you use, and you check the effectiveness of that techniques. All right? So something like this. Right. Sir,
illuminative assessment. So evaluation, any specification, sir?
No, even that's what I'm saying. Illuminative test is your assessment of your own strategies, methods that you apply in teaching. This is not something, which method works better for you. You need to check that also. Otherwise, you will not know. You are doing something, you think this will work, but it doesn't work. And at the end, you see your children don't learn. So that is what you need to check. Your way of working. Most of us don't bother. Illuminate means enlighten. You need to enlighten yourself about your methods of teaching. Which methods are you using, and is it working well, helping you, transacting sessions nicely, helping learners to develop language skills? So you need to check your tools.
Sir,
don't go for all this complication. Try to understand simple concept that when you are cutting vegetables with a knife, you need to check whether the knife is sharp or blunt. Sometimes you don't bother about this. You try with put all your force and do, but again you cannot cut it. All right. So illuminative test to assess the sharpness of your methods. whether your methods you are adopting is working or not working.
That means teacher self-evaluation, sir.
Listen, when I'm talking to somebody, you should have patience to listen to. And then I'll come to you. Got the, Srilata madam, got the idea? Your own assessment of your own methods.
Okay, sir.
Got the idea?
Oh, yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Yeah, next, ask me. Yeah.
Sir, excuse me, sir. Sir, in Andhra Pradesh, we are already following formative and summative assessment. Sir, this illuminate...
Every year, all southern states are using formative process of evaluation. Illuminative test your own assessment of your old tools.
It is just like mirror image.
It is not only mirror image, it is assessing your own technique. Sometimes you become so blind about your methods, you don't bother whether your method is working or not. So you need to enlighten yourself about the process that you are adopting in teaching. Right?
Yes, sir. So, observation, ourselves.
Sir, illuminating is not a learning tool.
Assessment of your own methodology in helping in teaching learners, developing their language skills. What approaches are or methods, techniques, strategies are we using? Are they working or not? So you need to enlighten yourself.
Yes,
right?
Sir.
Sir, can we say this as teacher self-evaluation?
That is what I am saying. You need to assess. Yeah. All right. This is a different term you are using. But I am saying in simple word, you are making complicated.
Okay.
Right? You need to enlighten yourself about your process of teaching, whether it is right or wrong. All right. Sometimes you say, my class is learner centered. But if you videograph your lesson and see, you will see it is a teacher dominated. It is sometimes we assume that I am doing this way, but in reality, you are not doing it. So you need to assess it. All right. So some teachers, you know, they teach and they say, I'm doing learner-centered classroom. What is learner-centered classroom? The learner is most important. So learner take part everything. And if you record it, and you see, learner doesn't get sums. You are only talking. Right? So that is sometimes we assume I am doing, but you actually not doing. All right. So that's why we need to assess it. That's why you need to video record your own class transaction and see in the evening whether you are following the right approach as mentioned in the textbook. Note to the teachers. Philosophy of textbook is given. All right? Right. Is that clear now? So we'll switch over to the next point. So you got what is formative and summative, that we need to focus on process of learners learning to get good results. Result in the terms of learning the language. Not exam results, all right? Yes. Asha mentioned that illuminative, the word illuminative is enlightened, is to evaluate teacher's teaching. Means who will do that? He himself or her, she herself has to do it, all right? Like you check learner's progress, you should check your progress also. That is illuminative test. That is related to teaching, teachers. Formative, summative related to learners. Illuminative related to teachers. All right? Right. Good. So you got some. All right? Now, all this evaluation assessment begins with our awareness of teaching, of the objectives of teaching and objectives of evaluation. All right? So how many of you are aware of objectives of teaching. Objectives of teaching. Can you type in the chat box? What are the objectives of teaching English at high school level in your state? Can you type some idea? What is the broad goal and the objectives of teaching English as a second language in high school in your state?
Sir?
Type, sir, type in the chat box. Okay, that will do. That means you are not aware of teaching English, objectives of teaching English at high school level. Okay. Right, we'll talk about that. Stop typing. Okay. You see, this is the problem where when we do not know why you are going to market, what things do you think you will buy? This is a problem. Right? So today we'll clarify this, make yourself familiar with objectives of teaching. Okay, stop typing now. Stop typing. I could understand from your things, it is not, probably you are not completely familiar with each and everything of teaching of English. You are doing things based on your experience or ideas, but it should not happen. You should all be familiar with objectives of teaching. So let's quickly have a look at the main objectives of teaching, the broad goals, aims of teaching English at school level, high school level especially. Aim in teaching English is to train students to become independent and efficient users of English. That is the broad goal, that we want to make our students independent and efficient users of English. They can independently use English and use English efficiently. All right. So what is our hypothesis? At the end of the course, that is SSLC level, a student should be able to understand English spoken or read out to them. That is first one. Understanding is the first objective. Understand English spoken or read out to them. That is the first. Now don't type. Now concentrate. Try to understand what I'm saying. Because next time after attending this CLT program, you should not say, I do not know the objectives of teaching, or say whatever comes to your mind. You should be clear about. Once your target is clear, your activities will, follow the suit. So first thing is understand English. Understanding is important. Understand English is spoken or read out to them and the students. So you teach to help learners understand any English when spoken to them or read out to them. They will be able to listen to and understand. That is the first, understanding. Second is listen to and understand. All right. Whatever you say, they will listen to. That is help. Here focus is on listening. They should listen to and understand. If you say something orally, they should listen to. Without looking, without your writing on the board, whatever you say orally, they should listen to it carefully and understand. So first one is common understanding. Anything you say, they will understand. Second is listen to and understand. Third is carry out meaningful conversation in English. That is speaking. Carry out meaningful conversation. If you say, what is your name? They should be able to tell you what is their name. If you say, what do you mean by this? They should be able to say, I mean to say this. All right. They carry out conversation. How many people are there at home? What does your father do? Okay. What is he? Okay. What is your mother? Something like that. So she or he will be able to continue. Okay, that is carry out meaningful conversation. If I say it's a hot today, she or he should be able to say, yeah, I suppose so. Okay, I believe so. All right, something like they should be able to carry out conversation. That is speaking. So first one is understanding, second one is listening, next one is speaking, then called read silently and understand the main ideas in a passage. Reading is always silent. Initially, we lower primary, upper primary say shift from speaking to reading, so we allow them loud reading. But as they continue, they should focus on silent reading. Silent reading, more understanding. Loud reading, less understanding. All right, read silently on their own and understand the main ideas of the passage. What is said, main, general, overall idea. Not each and every point, but overall idea. This passage talks about this. All right, this paragraph talks about this. They should be able to, you know, say that, okay, understand that. Main points of the passage or a paragraph. That is called reading. Then express himself or herself in writing with relevance and clarity. They should be able to, you know, communicate through writing. They should be able to write a balanced paragraph using a topic sentence, example, addition, explanation, and conclusion. All right. Beginning, introduction, topic sentence, writing all these points, and then conclusion. They should be able to do that. And that is very crucial. Your SSLC exam result will increase only when you help children write that way, systematically. Anything we write a topic sentence, introduce the topic, and then topics and main sentence. Then we add an additional sentence to contribute to the topic. We sometimes give example called subpoint, main point and subpoint. We sometimes give an explanation, what it means. And finally, we summarize, conclude the sentence, concluding sentence. So if children write a four paragraph answer to a 10 mark questions and does everything systematically, then your children will get. But most of the cases, children do not know. They have the answer, but they do not know how to begin with and how to conclude it. That's why they get 6 out of 10, 5 out of 10. They don't get 10 out of 10. All right? So these are very crucial. This is one of the objectives, major objectives of teaching English at high school level. And then next is called study skills. Read on his own or her own with the help of dictionary or other reference books. Okay? They should be able to consult a dictionary. Atlas, find the meaning, okay? Encyclopedia, thesaurus, they should be able to find the meaning and the uses, how to write that, okay? That particular what in sentence, how to, you know, compile that, okay? Something like that. That is called studies. How to take note, how to make note, how to summarize, all right? Something like this. And then last one is called read simple English poems with enjoyment, all right? That is called literary skills. So first couple of skills that we have is called basic language and mental skill called understanding, mental skills, and then listening, speaking, reading, writing, then study skills, okay? Study skills, something like that, all right? And then literary skills. That is, literary skills refers to observation, comprehension, and appreciation. All right, these are these three are called literary skills. That first they observe a poem and try to discover the picture written in the poem. Picture, every poem is a picture, image, overall image, and this overall image is made with a small images. Right. So children will observe and trace that images. Because poems language of poetry is something different from the language that we talk about in our day-to-day life. So they are, in poem, poet doesn't say tall. Poet say towering height. Towering height gives a image. All right, towering, tower, towering height means tall. All right. Poet will not say green. Poet will say greener than the coral sea. So it creates a big image, pictures. The poet will not say old woman. They will say 100 years. 100 years old grandmother's shrunken face, all right, something like this. So they create a big picture, image. So children should understand, try to trust that image, small image, and the overall image of the poem. That is called observation, all right. And we should train them, and then understand as they observe. Understanding happens automatically. Like, and then once you understand, appreciation takes place automatically. Like, say, if you see a 6 months old baby in mother's lap and with a small, you know, nice small face, and you, the moment you see the baby, you look at this baby and baby smiles and you appreciate it automatically. So all these things happen automatically on a simultaneously. That is appreciation. So appreciation doesn't mean happiness. Appreciation doesn't mean only happiness. It is that touches your heart. You feel, you understand. It might be crying. So most of the, you know, when you watch movie, cinema, what happens? Sometimes you cry. Your crying means you are appreciating it. All right? Sometimes you feel so bad about this, the heroine, you know, and you feel pity for her and you cry. Because she is undergoing such kind of things. So that is appreciation. If you are crying, watching a movie, although you know it's a movie, but still you are crying, that means you are appreciating this. So that is what appreciation could be. Sad could be, happy could be. That's what is, you know, the mood. That. So that if you feel that, okay. So now that, like that, when you read a poem, there are forces around the table where we sit down for a cup of tea. Now, we set places for Terry, Mom, and me. We didn't chatter what we did during the day. Terry and me eat quickly and go out to play. Mom doesn't smile like she used to. She often sits and sighs. Sometimes we discover from our smudges that while we are out, she cries. Now, have I understood this? Have I understood this? Why do we go out? Why doesn't mom smile? What happens? Okay. Why do we eat so quickly? Why don't we talk about what we did during the day? Okay, something like this. So the image, the first essay, there are four chairs around the table, a big image. One dining table, four chairs. That means four people are sitting. And then what we talk, okay? We talk what we did during the day, what I did, what Terry did, what mom did, what dad did. We talk about. And mom is to smile. Now, all of a sudden, now we say, we set places for Terry, mom, and me. We don't put four chairs now. We put three chairs for mom, Terry, and me. Terry, mom, and me. For Terry, mom, and me. Why? Three chairs. And then we don't chatter what we did during the day. We don't talk about. And then Terry and me eat quickly and go out to play. Why do we eat quickly? Because mom doesn't smile. And what we discover? When we are out, mom cries. How do we discover? From the smudges of her crying. So that's what's called comprehension, understanding. So that what happens, okay, then we understand. So today, ladies and gentlemen, we talk about the basic language, you know, the objectives of teaching. That I said that objectives of teaching, you know, we have three categories of objects. One is basic language, mental skill. First one is mental skill, understanding. Second is basic language skills, listening, speaking, reading, and writing. Third is called study skills. All right. Skills that help us study on our own. And fourth is literary skills. So these are the four general objectives of teaching English at high school level. So more specifically, we say understand English spoken or read out to the learners. Listen to and understand it. Carry out meaningful conversation in English. Read silently and understand the main ideas of the passage in a passage. Or express himself or herself in writing with relevance and clarity. And read on his own or her own with the help of the dictionary or other reference books like Thesaurus, Encyclopedia, etc. And read simple English poems with enjoyment. So these are the broad objectives of teaching English at high school level in any state. All right. So keep this in mind. And with this keeping in mind, if you go and start teaching, so we'll be focusing on their understanding, focusing on their listening, speaking, reading, writing, and then the study skills, okay, helping them to find out meanings, okay, using dictionary, and then, you know, make note, summarize certain points, okay, and then read poems and enjoy it, all right? So if you have any questions, quickly ask, otherwise we'll call it a day. I have another session, face-to-face session.
Right now, you have pointed out four goals of this,
teaching at the high school level, okay.
First one, mental understanding, and the fourth one was literary skills. Could you please mention the second one and third one, sir?
Second one is basic language skill, listening, speaking, reading, and writing. Basic language skills. Next one third is one? Study skills. Study, S-T-U-D-Y, study skills. So fourth one is mental skill, basic language skills. Basic language skills means listening, speaking, reading, writing, and then study skills, and then literary skills.
Okay. So how can we differentiate the first two goals provided here? In the sense, understand English spoken or read out to them, and then listen to understand it. How can we differentiate these two, sir?
This is more or less look like same, but it's some. Here focus is on understanding, their focus is on listening. Okay. First one, when mental skill, focus is on understanding. Whatever you say, whether we understand or not. But here is listening is more, focus is on listening. Understanding is common, but focus is on listening, that you listen and understand. But first one, whether you are listening, whether you read it or whether you speak it, they should be able to understand. Understanding is more focused. All right?
Thank you, sir.
Okay. So, if there is no question, I'll log out and you continue next for the next session. I have another session, face-to-face. So, we'll continue this. Don't worry.